the Off-Grid Prep Things Podcast.
Hello, Off-Grid Preppers.
Good evening.
Today, we're talking about I can, you can, we all can, but should we?
But should we?
That's the question you must ask yourself. Unless you just really like canning and it's your hobby, in which case, just can all the things. I don't care. I'm not your mom.
I don't want to use vinegar this year.
Yeah, we're going to try to avoid doing that kind of pickling. We're talking about canning.
We are.
We do a lot of canning. We don't do as much as some people because being off-grid, we don't have to think about losing power to our freezers.
Mm.
So a lot of people who don't have solar probably can some like shelf stable meat and stuff. We just don't worry about that. We just put it in the freezer because if I'm out of power, it's all going down. We have backups for the backups for the backups.
That is a point. There are certain markers in our life where if that thing breaks, like,
then what?
It's all gone.
For all the solar and the backup freezer, if everything's done, I don't know. Just till me in. Start over.
We're going caveman.
Do you want to talk quickly about quantities and what a year's worth of canned food looks like? Because I think some people, they get a couple dozen flats of jars and they think, I'm good for the apocalypse.
Well, we did.
And until recently, it's been very hard to get jars.
It has.
Yeah.
Every year we need about 200 jars of applesauce. You're looking at 20 jars of cranberries, 250 jars of canned fruit.
Just random, like in water. We like them in water.
We do, yeah.
Apples and water.
They seem
water.
To last. Blueberries. Blueberries and water. Raspberries. 20 jars of salsa. You're looking at 54 jars of mushroom soup.
Yeah, because we use it for recipes and stuff.
440 jars of assorted canned veggies. Like, these numbers are pretty intimidating once you start going down the list.
If you're not going to the grocery store all winter long,
yeah,
that's what it takes.
It really does. It's a commitment on a whole other level.
Yeah. It's nice to not have that grocery bill every week, though.
It really is. There's broth, too. And broth is actually really easy to do, but
yeah, doing broth is important if you're not going to keep all your stuff in your freezer. We usually will just like go through the beef, fill freezer bags full of like the bones and little bits and scrappies from vegetables and stuff, and then when we get a whole big stock pot worth, we'll make a batch of broth. We don't like try and can a year's worth of broth because
no, like we you have use it space. You go through a certain amount of meat and then yeah, you save all the fat,
yeah,
the trimmings and mm-hmm, the beef, or sorry, the fat and the bones. And then you make a really great batch mm-hmm of broth, you put it in the fridge, and then you use it.
Yeah.
To make stew and yeah, casserole.
All in, we don't do meat, and that would be about 1,000 pounds that we would need canned. So that's like basically 1,000 pint jars, because you,
yep,
without bones, you roughly get a pound of meat per pint jar.
Mm-hmm.
Without that, we still aim for 1,500 jars per year. That's what it takes, and that's not like for a whole year's worth, of course. That's from like November till June, 8 months.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're eating from your garden and you got fresh stuff and you're not really eating a lot of canned stuff, and then you start to fill it up again.
Mm-hmm.
So if we had to do meat, it'd be more like 2,500. And speaking of knowing your quantities and knowing what's in your pantry, it's time to thank our first sponsor of the day, which is the Off-Grid Prep Family Homesteading Planner. Available now on Amazon. There's a few options now on Amazon, and there's even an option for whether you have dairy animals that you need to do chores for or not, and a bunch of different covers. And if you want a custom cover, you can send us your image and we can do that too. It has garden planners and monthly budgets and daily layouts for all your mom chores, homeschooling, kid chores, all the things. It also has livestock planners, household inventories, pantry inventories, the freeze-dried food inventory, your seasonal clothing switch checklists, a bunch of emergency preppy stuff like bug out bag checklists and evacuation and family emergency plans.
Nice.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff, and it's 500 pages even.
It's a big book.
It's a huge book.
We got the proof the other day. It was a little bit intimidating.
So if you want to get in on that, you can go to Amazon and search for the Off-Grid Prep Family Planner, or I think we link it in our Off-Grid Gear page as well. And if you want to print it yourself because you're feeling ambitious, you can download that from our store. It's about half the price, but then you had to print it yourself. So
it's a lot of ink, man.
That's your call.
It's a lot of ink.
So moving on, it's a lot to can if you're trying to can all the stuff yourself.
Yes.
There are a lot of things that do make sense to can yourself, even just from a quality standpoint. And if you're getting a ton of food out of your garden, you got to do something with it.
Yeah.
But just as an example, because I've never done the math before today, I wanted to do a cost breakdown.
We were just trying to survive.
Yes, just and put the just, food
just
in
the cans. Put the food in the cans! So today, so you did the math.
A little more thoughtful, because I know you love math. I love math.
I do.
If you wanted to can 48 jars of your own beautiful organic tomato sauce, and you had no equipment in your house.
Mm.
So this is the most expensive it would be, because a lot of this equipment, of course, is reusable.
Right. First time. Yep.
Let's say you had to buy tomato plants. 12 plants, that's $8 easy, especially organic. Pepper plants, 6 plants, that's $4. Ours usually $3.99 for a 6-pack. Onion sets, you only need a dozen, but you're going to have to buy a whole bag, $3.
Yep.
A tablespoon of vinegar for each jar, that's 60 cents for the whole batch. Let's say you've got to buy some organic fertilizer, like you don't have chickens or compost, that's $9.97 on Amazon today.
And tomatoes are hungry.
Tomatoes are big feeders. Canning jars, if you don't have them yet, you'll be lucky to find them for $1 a jar. So that's $48. And if you wanted to get a pressure canner, the 23-quart Presto is on Amazon today for $2.99.
I feel like this is a good point. When you're talking about canning,
yeah,
the actual type of canning, we're going to go into detail in this further.
Right, but I would suggest just getting the pressure canner,
because then you can can everything.
You can can everything in the pressure canner. It doesn't take as long. It doesn't take as much water. It doesn't take as much fuel to get it up to temperature.
We're going to talk about methods of canning, yeah, and why we do and do not use certain methods of canning.
But you could, later, if you're feeling not so flush, you could do the water bath canner.
Mm-hmm.
And that's like $110 now on Amazon, which is so insane. That's
relatively not a lot less than a pressure canner.
Yeah. But you can can everything.
Yeah.
It's going to take you some sort of fuel to cook the sauce, probably for at least 2 hours. If you don't have your wood stove running yet, that's propane. It's $2.
Well, 2 to 10.
No, well, 2 hours.
Oh, I suppose. Okay.
Per hour, I looked up the BTU of our large burner on our stove, and it uses about a gallon per hour, which is about... So, at $2 a gallon, you're using a half a gallon per hour, so you're going to use $2 worth of propane to get your sauce ready. You're going to use another $1.50 to run your batch. And for these 48 jars, it's going to take you 7 batches. So 10 hours of using that burner just to run them through. That doesn't include bringing the water up to temperature or anything else. So initially, this first round of tomato sauce, it's going to cost you $385.07. That works out to 50 cents an ounce.
Hmm.
The Costco 3-pack organic tomato sauce works out today 19 cents per ounce.
Now, is that Canadian or is that American?
That's Canadian.
Okay. So there's a little bit of conversion there, so it's maybe even less per ounce American?
It could be, yeah.
That's a big difference.
If you already had the equipment and the jars and you just had to buy the flat lids, and if you got the lids at a really good price, like you got it, you know, the tube of 100 or the little gross of 12 by 12, you can get them for 10 cents a lid. That batch will only cost you $42.87. That's 6 cents an ounce.
So that makes sense.
Free
versus
food,
20 cents an ounce.
Free food, free jars, you've got the equipment, and your time's worth nothing.
Right. So it's a third the price to do it yourself, but this is once you're all set up.
And it's my time is worth nothing, which I don't know about you, but my time is not worth nothing.
It is not.
If you had to buy the vegetables, you could afford to pay up to 71 cents a pound for those veggies before Costco becomes more economical.
That's pretty cheap.
I don't think I would ever get veggies for 71 cents
not,
a pound.
Not in Canada.
So for a batch of 48, if you're looking for the math, because we do large batches, you need 161 pounds of tomatoes, you need 14 pounds of peppers, and 7 pounds of onions.
Hmm.
So if you can get them for less than 71 cents a pound, and you've got all the equipment, and your time's worth nothing, you're going to beat Costco.
That's
a lot of things to line up in your favor.
Enlightening.
But, what if your time isn't worth nothing?
Like, you value yourself in any way whatsoever?
Okay, so just, if you're going to just watch the canner, and not even like the chopping, peeling time, this has already cost you 9 hours. If you add just 1 hour for chopping and peeling and getting everything ready, which means you're an epic canner, way faster than I am,
mm-hmm.
we're going to call it 10 hours of your time. Right?
Mm-hmm. That sounds about right.
Okay, minimum wage here is just over $13. If your time is worth $13 an hour and your ingredients are all free, you've saved seeds, you have zero fertilizer costs, all you're buying is lids, vinegar, and propane. It still costs 19 cents per ounce. It's the exact same price as Costco for the organic
Costco.
That's
a lot of effort.
That's a lot of effort.
Now, I want to take this time to point out that these supply chains are going to change very fast.
And as prices go up, more of these homegrown things make more sense.
They do make more sense.
So at the very least, you should know how to do them.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the muscle memory, you know your recipes, you know how you like it. But it's hard to justify if it's not like a very specialty thing that your family's like, oh, mom, I gotta have those pickled beets, and you know they're expensive to buy at the grocery store, then I don't know if I'm gonna do tomatoes this year after seeing that.
The prices are still really low.
What, they're higher than they should be, but it still doesn't make sense to burn that fuel or to go to all that effort. I could better spend that effort prepping other things.
Well, and the quality of the salsa that you can get from, say, Costco, for example, versus homegrown, it's not that much different.
It really isn't. If you're buying the organic, I don't know.
Yeah. So that's a lot really good info there.
It's not the way that I thought this episode was going to go.
No.
Because when I sat down
you thought
to
you were going to have this amazing idea.
When I sat down
honestly,
to do the math today, I was like, I'm going to prove that canning saves you a ton of money.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm like, sometimes?
I'm not impressed.
Yeah. I'm not blown away.
Now, learning those skills for the future.
Yeah. Having all the equipment.
Being prepared.
Knowing the recipes you like, knowing how it's done so you have the muscle memory so you're not like figuring something out in an already stressful time. That's all very valuable.
It is. Yeah.
But to can up the 2,500 cans that I need every year, I don't know.
Yeah.
I feel like I could be doing something more useful that gets us further ahead in other ways.
Yeah.
So, womp.
we'll put the energy into the fresh vegetables.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's some things that you can't get at the store in the same quality, and there's lots of things that don't require canning, like all our cabbages and, you know, the potatoes and the carrots and the beets and things like that.
Now, to be clear, we farm with no machinery whatsoever outside of a rototiller.
Yeah.
We have a small tiller. I think it's got an 18-inch wide tiller assembly on it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't use a tractor mower, like, this is all by hand.
Yeah.
And it's doable. It's not that difficult, which is why we use landscape fabric.
Yeah.
But what I'm getting at is the a crop, for example, is corn.
Yeah.
We have a lot of trouble making corn match buying corn. Like.
Yeah, we could never buy corn for our large family in any large amount at the grocery store. Like, we'd probably just buy it like a couple times a year.
Yeah.
But if we grow that corn, we can have corn all of August, September, October, as much as we want, and then fill our freezer with it.
It is, yeah.
So, making those choices and doing the math, it allows you to, like everything else with prepping, make better decisions with your time and your effort so that you can get further ahead.
Yep.
So before we move on to the second topic of the day, we should really thank our sponsor of the day.
Major Mom's Ground Control.
It's pretty epic.
It's kind of scary, honestly. It works in minutes.
If it's sunny out, it works in minutes.
Sprayed it on some broadleaf weeds and some ground creeping weeds, whatever those
grass.
Are called, grass.
Yeah.
And the stuff turns gray and visibly dies within 15, 20 minutes. The next morning you come out and it's just like desert. It's just yellow and crumbly.
It's amazing.
I've never seen it. We've used Roundup and this is far
better. It's faster.
It's faster.
And it's all natural ingredients. A bunch of like organic fair trade oils.
I think that's one of the things that helps it work is it's got different oils in it and that binds it to the leaf.
And it has like chrysanthemum, chive, garlic, a couple different kinds of wild mint.
It also gets rid of the bugs.
That's what gets rid of the bugs.
We sprayed it in our courtyard, and the next day, there were no mosquitoes.
It was amazing.
It was unbelievable.
It's been over a month, and it's just starting to be like, maybe we need to reapply. Like, every once in a while, you get one.
But that said, it's getting close to bugs are starting to die out season, and we might not have to.
We might not have to.
So, it's price comparable with Roundup and other things, Kill-X. But it's also an insecticide, and it's all natural. It's an amazing product.
And you don't have to worry about your kids and your dog running around in your yard. And if you go to our website to buy it and our store, and you use the coupon code OGPF, you get free shipping within the U.S. and Canada, and I think it's $15 off.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I think there's a limited number of uses on that coupon code, so if you want it, go get it. Since we've already done our math on canning.
Which is, there's some good stuff and some not so exciting
You gotta do the math.
Yeah. Divorcing the grocery store.
It's important.
You do. You gotta cut that thing off like a dead hand.
Yeah. The more you have to go there, the more you're gonna spend.
And the longer you've been away from the grocery store, when you go back, it is a culture shock. Mm-hmm. It's like zombie apocalypse. Like,
it is.
People are just walking around with
They're just buying the same things every week without thinking about it.
And that's what the modern grocery store, at least in Canada, I should point out that we've been to American grocery stores. They are amazing.
Yeah.
In Canada, grocery stores have built their entire existence upon people making poor choices.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just
gross.
A sick entity. All of it. Yeah. All of the grocery chains in Canada
used to
are
be
very
if you
disturbing
stayed out
and
of
sick.
The, if you stayed out of the middle of the grocery store,
it
was fairly healthy. But now there's junk and the outside,
it's just junk
too.
Everywhere. But and the prices have quadrupled and the stocks and they're doing
and
all
they
this.
Did ridiculous stuff for the you know what.
Yeah, and this year they like 2 years ago they would coordinate sales with when families got their checks out here.
Yeah, and also it was like if you had the time to hunt for the deals, it's like they sprinkled the little deals around for you.
Intentionally, like almost to be nice.
Mm-hmm.
And it all disappeared.
It did.
And this year, what they did is they would actually go out the night before, and they still do this.
Yeah.
They pull the flyer items. So you go in the day of the flyer, and everything's gone.
The loss
like,
leaders that
the
make
morning.
You come in the store, they pull them off the shelves on Wednesday nights.
They're straight up evil.
Or they leave like 8.
Yeah. They're
but
just
more often, if it's a really good loss leader, they pull it off the shelf. They scooch the other sections over, so it looks like, oh no, we don't actually carry that item.
We did this experiment. Yeah. We went in the day of, and everything was gone, and I went back the next day, or whatever, the day after
Thursday,
the flyer was gone,
and
everything was back on the shelf.
Yeah. That's
like,
gross.
It is
so
gross.
So they don't want our business.
Yeah.
We don't want theirs.
There are many alternatives.
And they're all healthier. We would suggest doing a no-spend month, or even a stay-out-of-the-store-for-the-whole-summer experiment, if you can.
You can. There are options. We've talked about commercial wholesale places and local producers before. You can find your food elsewhere.
But if you just choose to like pretend like the grocery store is not there.
For 1 month, do a no-spend month. And when you go back, you will wonder why you ever went there.
Yeah, and you'll find alternatives in the meantime. Yeah. And those little things that you often go to the grocery store, they become glaringly obvious.
Mm-hmm.
And those may be the meals that you need to rework.
Yeah.
If you're going to go to the grocery store, we would definitely suggest flash food. Flash food is great for preppers.
Flash food is great.
Sometimes there's amazing stuff.
Yogurts, Oiko yogurts the other day.
The really big ones.
Fruit on the bottom, like the high quality yogurt.
We get a lot of like really good organic, free, like grass-fed produce and like dairy stuff there because anything that's too expensive right now
because of
inflation, nobody buys it and it ends up on flash food.
It has to expire.
And so we get like fancy cheeses and nobody buys them.
And still nobody buys them because the prices are so high.
But then you get it for a dollar.
Yeah.
So you can really fill your pantry. We've gotten really good deals on giant amounts of like crackers and sauces and hot sauce and
stuff you'd never expect to buy, but it's there.
And we all know about expiry dates.
There's a coupon on our website on the friends page for flash foods, a $5 off, which that's a whole produce box.
Yeah, that's like
mixed produce, onions and limes and just weird
random stuff. Like it's very rare that you get something that's actually moldy.
Actually, and even
give it to the chickens.
We when we do flash food, I find that there's no more bad stuff in there than a normal grocery run.
I completely agree. Also, local sources.
Yeah.
So just like hit Facebook, hit the marketplace.
Hit the used. You have no idea how many people are selling beets and
giving them away.
Come pick our strawberries and apples
and sometimes like if you've got a neighbor that's got an overladen apple tree, like. Often they'll be happy to just have you pick it and just leave them a basket of apples.
We've met so many people who they just let their apples hit the ground every year. Like they just can't deal with
them. It's too much to deal with. And so they'd rather not have them.
So there is food out there. You do not have to get it from the grocery store.
There's food in your neighborhood and there's people who would love to sell it to you. Sometimes you would have to specifically ask them because maybe they
haven't thought of it.
No, or it's not worth their time to even advertise, right? Finding a local like food co-op or a CSA. If you live where Spud is in operations,
that's only
Spud
a West Coast thing. Yeah.
But there's lots of places that are like that.
That's true. Yeah. Grocery delivery and they source.
I would frankly rather pay more.
Mm-hmm. At this point,
and have it just delivered to my house, what I need. It keeps you on budget because you know exactly how much it's going to be before it gets to your door. Mm-hmm. You're not getting all those impulse things.
Yeah.
And it's all local. It's better for you and you're supporting the people in your community.
Yeah, so now we're getting back into, we've talked about the grocery store and there are so many alternatives. We want to talk about growing what you're good at.
Yeah.
And we've talked about this before. We're still learning what we can grow and when.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes you're really good at growing one thing and it might not be what you particularly even like or need.
Or have even thought of.
Yeah.
We can grow grapes without doing anything.
Yeah, and so that becomes the thing that you're going to trade and barter for the things that you aren't good at growing or that you can't grow. And so if you can do a whole lot of grapes and somebody else can do a whole lot of beef, that's a pretty easy trade.
It is. Yeah. This kind of ties in with simplifying your diet, which is really important. So part of this is really reassessing what you need and what your family needs, and you'd be surprised how many things that most of us eat and buy that we just do not need.
Yeah.
So you want to simplify your diet to a more localized seasonal diet.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense for us to all be eating avocados every single day and living in North America.
No, we're just that. It's
nice.
It's obscene.
But it's pretty crazy.
We just finished pea month.
Yeah.
Everybody's sick of peas now.
So now the freezer's full of peas, the kids are full of peas. Yep.
Cucumber month is just getting started.
Mm-hmm.
We got our first 4 cucumbers yesterday. We found them hidden
while
we were trellising cucumbers up. And we know we're going to be sick of cucumbers by the time that's over. And that's all
And then we'll have a pantry full of cucumbers.
Even our potatoes are just starting. They're early. We got them in really early.
Yep.
And now we had potatoes the last two meals.
Yeah. And so we're going to harvest all our potatoes in the next day or two. And then we'll either plant on second round.
Mm-hmm.
Or we'll plant those 9 or 8 rows with something else.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's plenty of time. But you just got to grow what grows there, and that's what you eat. That's
and
what you
eat it
base.
when it happens.
Yeah.
And you'd be surprised the health benefits. It's like you're resyncing yourself, not to the drum of a propaganda-based society.
Fall, you eat apples.
Yeah.
And then you store them, and they're good till, you know,
I never thought
Christmas.
I'd get sick of a fresh tomato, but you do.
Yeah.
But then when it's tomato season, it's like, where have you been all my life?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
If you want to look at your yearly grocery list by doing the food storage meal plan calculator that's on our website, you can really find those meals that cost you a lot of money and that really can't grow yourself.
Yeah.
So what I do is I go through the ingredients list, and everything that I can grow or barter for, I mark it to zero.
This is an important part of the process because one meal we've talked about before that I'm going to bring up again is grilled cheese sandwiches and tomato soup.
Store-bought tomato soup.
We were all raised of our generation that this was the cheap go-to meal. Mm-hmm. It is one of the most expensive meals you can make. Once you add up the price of buying decent bread, not
Well, I'm pretty sure that our math was even with homemade bread.
Was it?
Yeah.
So we weren't even buying the bread.
It was store-bought cheese, and it would have been store-bought tomato soup.
It would have been low-end Campbell's standard tomato soup and store-bought cheese. So not even high-quality ingredients. And we should look up the number.
I think it was $8 and something to
feed
our family.
$8 per person or something?
No. For the meal, but that's really high.
But that was really high, yeah.
Yeah, like we usually spend under $5 a meal.
So now
to feed the nine of us.
We've begun this year making our own pasta.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, it's loaded with eggs.
Yeah.
Of course, our own free-range eggs. And
you just start leaning heavy on those things that you can produce.
And we don't remember the last time we ate grilled cheese and tomato soup.
No, it would
and
probably make you sick.
It used to give me a tummy ache. That was one of the reasons we stopped. I said, I can't eat this anymore. Not the cheese in particular, but the way it was presented, the whole thing.
Yes.
Anyway.
So you find those meals that maybe you need to replace with something else. And until you do the math, it's just like the canning.
Mm-hmm.
Until you do the math, you don't know.
Yeah, and that ties in with getting the local groceries. We have several sources of local meat that...
It's mostly word of mouth, like you've
got
to
dig. It's word of mouth. You have to find it, but once you find it, like the steak that we've been eating this year, I don't remember the last time I had steak
and
like
I certainly couldn't afford to buy steak at the grocery store right now.
And we're getting it for $5 a pound.
Yeah.
Which is, I don't even know, a tenth of what you'd pay for the same cuts at the deli?
Yeah.
Like...
And it's like
they just hold you hostage.
And, yeah,
they could do everything at 100% markup and make a ton of money, and they choose to do worse. Like the they choose to be even.
Why do better if you can do worse?
Oh, it's awful.
So, divorce your grocery store. That is the message of the day. Do you have a quote for us to wrap up?
This is a quote from Dwight Yoakam.
Mm-hmm.
I live out of cans a lot, but I try to indulge only in healthy canned food.
Thank you, Dwight Yoakam.
Do you remember him in Panic Room?
Yeah, he was great.
He was he's actually a phenomenal actor. He was in Wedding Crashers, too, at the beginning.
You never recognize
him. You never recognize him, and he seems like a really cool guy.
He does.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening. If you found this podcast helpful, could you please share it with a friend or post it somewhere on social media or maybe even give us a 5-star review. Make it fun and we'll put it on the next episode.
Right on.
And if you've got questions, you can get us on Instagram. Thanks for listening.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you. Thank you.